번째 주제 강연으로 이어가 보도록 하겠습니다. 두 번째 주제 강연은 IAPCO의 마티아스 포쉬 대표님께서 준비를 해주셨는데요. 단상으로 모시고 함께 이야기 나눠보도록 하겠습니다. Could you please come up to the stage? 네, 단상으로 모시겠습니다. 여러분 뜨거운 박수 부탁드리겠습니다. Okay, I will deliver the microphone. Okay, how about this one?
Let's do this. Perfect. So this is working. Thank you for everybody who stayed behind. This is going to be a little bit of a summary of some of the things you already heard, and maybe some of the new things that you haven't heard yet. But what I want to talk about is global trends and the future of the international conference industry. And before I start, I want to kind of outline that I'm doing this on behalf of. I have two hats, basically. I run my own PCO company, which is International Conference Services, and we run meetings around the globe. We have 8 offices in Europe, Asia, and North America. But I'm also right now president of the International Association of Professional Congress Organizers. And the International Association of Professional Congress Organizers is a quality accreditation for professional congress organizers. We have members all around the globe, and I'm very happy to say that Korea is we have the most members of all Asian countries in Korea. So Korea is a very highly developed MICE market for sure. So that's great. We have a few members also in the room here. The thing about predicting the future is it's difficult. There is a quote, which is, we don't like their sound. Groups of guitars are on the way out. Who said that? Decca Records in 1962. And who did they say it about? The Beatles. So when we try to predict things, we very often get it wrong. Very often we don't get it quite right. We can only look at what's happening right now and where does this might lead us in the future. And that's exactly what we're doing in this session. So let's look at right now. Let's look at the world as it is right now. And this map gives you a bit of an idea of the economic activity in the world. When you look at the globe at nighttime and you see the lights in an area, you see how densely it's populated, how well developed it is, and how much is happening. And this gives you a very good overview of where the world is right now, and it gives you a very interesting overview of where Korea sits in this part of the world. It sits in an area where there's still a lot of very dark areas. There's not a whole lot of activity happening. So there's a whole lot of opportunity in this part of the world. So the next few years are very exciting years for this part of the world. We heard a lot about automation, AI, and robotics, so I won't go too much into it, but it's definitely something that we will see influencing us a lot more in our industry and also in our daily lives. A lot more will be automated. We will deal with these things on a daily basis. And that will change the way how we will work in the future. Jobs that we take for granted today might not be there anymore tomorrow. But jobs that we don't even know exist today will be the jobs of the future. So we talked about the Industrial Revolution, and in the previous session you heard about it. So the big driver of what's happening now is intelligence. It used to be steam, then it was electricity, then it was computing, and now it's intelligence. So everything turns around that. And that really kind of is reflected in the way big companies are operating and which companies are actually successful these days. In just 10 years, the biggest companies in the world, that this is by market capitalization, so if you sell all your shares, how much money would you get out of it? The biggest companies in the world in 2006 were General Electric, ExxonMobil, Microsoft, lots of resource-heavy traditional businesses. In 2016, it was almost all tech companies. Apple, Alphabet, that's the mother company of Google, Microsoft, Amazon, and so on. Only ExxonMobil remained. So think about 2026. If in 10 years it can change so much that companies that weren't even represented before are now leading by so far, which companies are going to be the companies that are going to lead this in 2026? Which companies don't we even know yet that will do this? Which products don't we even know that will hit such a huge market capitalization factor? So in short, Apple could buy Disney or Coca-Cola if they wanted to, easily. And about 10, 15 years ago, nobody would have thought that would be possible. Another thing that's really important when we talk about global trends is political, environmental, all of those economic bigger issues that really affect us. Everything affects us. Our industry, the mice industry, is affected by pretty much everything that happens around us. So when you look at this graph, we had Guy talk about the environmental impact that we have, and we see that in more natural catastrophes. You have typhoons coming, you have extreme weather happening. All this impacts the way people will be traveling in the future, and it impacts us in a way how we can conduct business. So we cannot look at this and say this is an isolated issue. It's not just for the good of the world that we want to change the environment or that we want to do something about global warming. It's for our own business as well. Political unrest, all of those things, of course, have a huge impact on us. And if we just look at this region right now, and this is just what's been happening in the last few weeks and months. So we have the protests in Hong Kong, we have cooling relationships between Korea and Japan, we have a warming relationship between Russia and China, especially militarily, and then we have a very dangerous situation in India on the border to Pakistan and Kashmir. So all of those things are happening in this region, and all of these things influence how people perceive this region and how people perceive the safety of this region and how good it is to do business here. So we need to keep that in mind when we move forward with conferences and with our marketing. And overall, this area is actually quite a good area on this Asian continent. Another trend I really want to go into before going more into the mice industry is looking how communication works these days. Communication is faster than it's ever been before. We can really reach huge audiences in a very short time. And a good parameter to look at this is the number of years it took for each of these products to reach 50 million users. For the car, it took 62 years to have 50 million users. You then jump forward, the internet, 7 years. Twitter, 2 years to get 50 million users. And get this, 19 days for Pokemon Go. 19 days to get 50 million users. That gives you a good indication how if something is well designed, if something is well done, if something really captures your imagination and your creativity, things can happen extremely fast. People is another thing that will be changing tremendously in the next few years. This is how the pyramid of kind of like the generational pyramid looked in 1950. Lots of young people supported a small amount of older people. This is how the pension system worked, but this is just how our life cycles worked. Younger people drove a lot of innovation. Younger people drove the economy. Older people rested and kind of took their time out. By 2060, we'll have pretty much an even split between younger and older people. What does that mean? It means, A, we have a big problem with our pension system, that's one issue. But number two is, it's not all driven by one generation, two generations anymore. There's multiple generations in the workforce, which means we will have to really adapt to working together in a different way. It also means the people that attend conferences will span from 20 to 70, 80 years. What does it mean for accessibility issues? What does it mean for proper collaboration between the generations as well? So we really will have a much more even split between different ages. We talked about companies earlier as well, and what companies are doing and how they're reinventing themselves ongoingly. And our industry is actually, I would say maybe not the best, but also not the worst when it comes to reinventing ourselves. But when you look at these things, you have Uber, which is the world's biggest, largest taxi company that didn't own any vehicles. You have Facebook as the world's most popular media owner that created no content. You have Alibaba as the most valuable retailer that has no inventory, and so on and so on. We thought these were the business models of the future. I don't know how many of you read the business news, but 2 days ago, Uber kind of released their numbers of the last quarter, and they had record losses again, record losses. They haven't been able to pull a profit in a long time. So all these things that if I gave this talk 5-6 years ago, I would have said, this is the future. Nobody's doing things, nobody's keeping inventory anymore. Everybody just builds on service. But now we see some of those things failing. And what's actually happening is Uber is buying cars. Facebook is creating content. So is Netflix, for example. Didn't start out that way. Amazon carries their own inventory. Airbnb is buying real estate. Things change. We thought this is the new revolution. We thought things, this was the old way. The new way was coming. We're back full circle to the old way. So just because something looks shiny doesn't mean always it's the new way of doing things. All in all, if we sum this up, our world is a VUCA world, which means it's volatile, it's uncertain, it's getting incredibly complex. And my favorite example for complexity is Starbucks. If you go into a Starbucks, how many different drinks can you get for yourself? How many different choices can you make for yourself? If you would consider every single day what Starbucks coffee would get, and you would think about it every single day, you would spend an hour in the lineup. There's over 1,000 different combinations you can get at Starbucks. You take a latte, which is different sizes, different milk choices, differently sweet, different this, different that. What does end up happening? We all get the same drink every single day because we can't deal with the complexity anymore. And this is our world right now. The world's getting too complex, so we're feeling very comfortable in areas where we don't have to make those decisions anymore on an ongoing basis. And it's crazy ambiguous. It's not always so clear. In this VUCA world, things might happen very quickly. And to go into something that's similar to our industry, the Detroit Auto Show. If you're a car fan, you know that the Detroit Auto Show is the number one trade show case showcase for new car models. Mercedes-Benz was saying they're thinking of pulling out of the Detroit Auto Show. Unheard of in the past. Why would they do that? That's the prime show. Well, they find new ways of getting to the customer. They don't think this old way is working anymore. So we can never rely on things. We're very VUCA. Things are changing very quickly, volatile. I'm talking mostly about when I'm going into next trends that I'm gonna go a few statistics that I'm prepared for you. I'm talking mostly about the association market because I find we're gonna hear a lot about corporate markets and corporate clients. Association clients, association conferences are very unique in their way. First of all, their biggest problem is they're very, very slow in adopting because they're run by boards. Second of all, they do usually have a business model that's very outdated. It's very old in a way. And in that business model, there's a lot of fears that associations have right now. So when you bid on any conference that's coming to Goyang or to Korea, when you're looking at managing any of those conferences, a lot of concerns are going to be reflected in how the client talks to you. One of them is membership. Most associations are based on membership. They're really worried about getting new members and keeping their old members because we are in this VUCA world. Things are happening very quickly. The new Pokemon Go is around the corner. They change. People are not loyal as long anymore. In the past, people joined association and stayed with the association for the rest of their life. Now, if there's better things coming up, they're moving. More competition, sponsorship. Do I get enough money? So people have, associations have a lot of these worries. And it's very important for us to know what those worries are when we work with them. And what we need in our people is changing rapidly as well. I got a couple of business cards from people that teach tourism and convention and event management. The most important thing that we teach these days would be these things, in my opinion. It's very important that people know how to do a budget, don't get me wrong. People need to know how to set up a meeting room. But at the end of the day, the most important things that people need to know is cross-cultural competencies. We're a very global world. We need to understand each other. And I don't mean language-wise. I mean in the way we interact with each other. Social intelligence. We see this changing way of how people will be working in the future. The only thing that stays the same is we will always deal with people. So we need to understand people. Transdisciplinary. That's big. I talked about AI. I showed you a robot at the beginning. So what comes to your mind? To your mind, if you're in the conference industry, you're like, oh, I need to go after robotic conferences and technology conferences. But robotics and AI have a huge impact on medicine, for example. There's robotic surgery. You can print 3D, you can 3D print organs. Functioning organs are 3D printed. So it's all overlapping. It's not this is medical, this is technology. We need to work together. Virtual collaboration. Traveling around the globe is not sustainable. We need to get a real understanding of when do we travel, a conference, but where do we not need to travel anymore, a site visit or a planning meeting. So very important to say like, okay, what is essential travel and what is not. Adaptive thinking, quick changing. If the world is changing around us, we cannot sit there and say everything was so much easier in the past. We need to move on and go with the next thing that's happening. And we consistently work with a cognitive overload. So much information is coming towards us. Alone what you're doing today, you're sitting in a room and you're having four keynote lectures plus panels, that's a lot. If you get 5 to 6 take-home messages from this, you're lucky. And that is actually what everybody's dealing with. This is what our delegates are dealing with as well. So it's very important that we kind of learn how to manage this and learn how to channel things. So this are the number one things that I expect from my staff when I hire them. And I think this is really what makes the staff of the future successful. So this is a lot of general things. Let's go into the meetings industry and let's look, in order to look into the future, we need to look into the past a little bit. So let's look what happened in our industry. And I'm looking at the association industry and ICA provides fantastic data on this. Noor is not here anymore, but Noor is from ICA and my company and many companies in the room are probably also ICA members. And ICA members provide data to ICA and they have done so for the last 55 years. So ICA has launched a report of the trend lines over the last 55 years of where the meeting industry has gone. And some of those findings are really interesting because they show very clear trend lines. Just in order for the ones of you that are not that familiar with ICA, the meetings that qualify for this statistic have to take place on a regular basis, no one-off meetings. They have to rotate between a minimum of 3 countries and to have at least 50 participants. Okay, so this is the only meetings that have been looked at here. Let's look at how it's been going in the last 55 years. Total number of meetings going up, despite what people have been saying. Again, if I gave this talk 15 years ago, I would have said virtual meetings will kill on live meetings. Everybody went around and said the virtual technology will kill live meetings. It has not happened. It's been going up ever since and it hasn't had any dip. What's the number of meetings per region? And this is where it gets really interesting for this region. Europe has been declining number of meetings. North America is slightly declining. the number one growth you can see has been Asia and Latin America. These are the growth markets, and these curves are not changing. These curves are going on further. They might be getting a bit steeper in the future because things are happening faster. If you look at the number of meetings per country, absolute, over 55 years, which countries have done really well? Of course, the United States for a long time. Then you see Germany, but you see Korea on 12th, in 12th place already. That is impressive for a small country. The number of meetings per city, Seoul is doing incredibly well in the comparison with the rest of the world. And that is over 55 years. And you see here also the trend line, 63 to 67, 4 meetings. In 13 to 17, 691 meetings. Exponential growth. In Asia Pacific, Korea is doing incredibly well as well. Third place in total meetings. Also, when you come to cities, not just Seoul, there's also Jeju and Busan who do extremely well. Here's where some of the call it not so good news for second tier destinations comes up. The number of delegates is declining. So overall, we see less mega meetings that have lots and lots of meetings, lots and lots of delegates, and more meetings with less delegates. The categories of participants, if you look at that, like which meetings did show the biggest growth, it was really meetings around 50 to 150 people. Also, you can see the more it gets, the more people, the less the increase. So meetings of 3,000 and up that we all are so interested in, they're really far and few in between compared to the total amount of meetings. Per region, again, look at how Asia is doing. Asia is doing slightly better than the rest. Numbers of people have been slightly increasing here. What subjects are the most interesting ones? Medical sciences, stable, bit of a decline. Technology is the big winner here. Lots more meetings in technology. And the type of venue. Convention centers. I heard today over lunch there's so many new convention centers being built in the region. Many have already been built and many being built still. But this is not the preferred venue of people where they meet. They meet in hotels with meeting facilities. Convenience. You see smaller meetings, more convenience. Universities are on a steep increase as well. I think that has a lot to do with the cost benefit of universities. So very interesting. And here's the average length of the meeting. It's going down. It's been going down steadily. When people attended a full week, it's now going down to about 3 days, 3.5 days. And I have more data in a bit that's going to underline that even more. So what's the summary of this? We see exponential growth in the number of international association meetings and meeting that's really continuing, and especially here in Asia. The most popular countries and cities change in every five-year period quite a bit. The average number of people in attendees per meeting decreases. As meeting gets smaller, the overall number of participants rises. That's very interesting. So we get more people going, but to more meetings, but smaller meetings. Regional rotation is a growing trend. Less international rotation, more regional rotation. And that is another area where I feel Asia-Pacific has still a lot to gain. There's still not enough Asia-Pacific regional meetings out there when you compare it to the counterparts in Europe and North America. Technological meetings grow, universities become more popular venue choices, and the durations of meetings getting shorter. If I go now into, this is ICA. This is us giving that information. Convention centers, convention bureaus, and PCOs, and so on. Let's go into a physician survey. Lots of us are hopefully working in the medical meetings world, and there is an interesting survey that Ashfield released. This is very new data. It's coming only in May this year. It was released, looking at what physicians prefer, and this has been renewed every 2 years. Unfortunately, the physicians surveyed in this one do not include any Asian countries. However, if you're in the international meetings market, this is interesting for you to know, to see how international people, how international doctors feel about this. They're from various medical fields: oncology, hematology, neurology, endocrinology, and cardiology. And here are some of the interesting outcomes. The ideal meeting length is getting shorter and shorter. It was 2016 in the survey 2.17, now it's 2.25, so it's about the same. It's not even 2.5 days that people want to attend a meeting. The next one is even more concerning if you're in a region as big as Asia, which is maximum number of hours willing to travel. Average in 2016 was 6.8, now it's 4.7. 4.7 hours. If you think about where we are right now and 4.7 hours, you get a lot of people, but you don't get North America, you don't get Europe, you don't get Australia, you don't even get Singapore or Kuala Lumpur or India. So that's a concern. And the maximum amount of days people want to be away from the office, that's lining up quite nicely, is around 3.5 days. So that really comes back to meetings getting shorter, smaller meetings. Why do people attend meetings? That's always important for us to know too, because we are often going around the wrong ideas. We are very often, especially, we're coming from the tourism industry very often. We think, okay, this is an interesting destination. Come visit us. We have beautiful temples. We have beautiful sites to see. No, this is not the number one thing. Most importantly for people, they want to learn new things. They want to network well. And if I think about that they would only want to travel for 4.5 hours, the accessibility of a good airport is fundamental. So no connections, close by airport, ideally, not a lot of transfer time. That is extremely important. When we look at what people want to get out of the conferences, it's really coming to how many conferences people attend. This is really good news. People attend a lot of conferences. We heard they attend shorter. We heard they attend only for 2.5 days. But in this survey, they came up with that they attend in a 24-month period, 2 years, 8.4 congresses on average. That's 4.2 conferences per year. That's a lot. So people are willing to go shorter, but they go to more conferences. It's good news for our industry. Why do people not go to conferences? That's a very important question too, because we usually ask people, why did you come? How did you hear from us? But this one also asks people that don't attend conferences, why don't you attend a conference? What's your main reason? Number one reason, time required out of the office to attend the conference, too much. Second, too expensive. Too far away, third one, distance to travel is too big. And then only in fourth place, lack of sponsorship opportunities, 29%. And anybody who's working in the medical field knows that we have been paranoid and panicking in the last few years about the fact that pharma companies do not invite doctors to meetings anymore because nobody will attend. It's still, with 29% of people, a very high number, but it's by far not the number one reason why they don't attend. And what do people like to attend? And that's also an interesting kind of difference between what they attend and what they like to attend. They like international meetings the most. So 85%, that's in the text down here, say they value international meetings the most. But then when you look at it, the meetings that they attend the most is national meetings. Why? Travel, time out of the office, convenience. OK? Okay, so how can we make international meetings more convenient, more easier to reach for people as well? And last but not least, I really want to kind of focus on this one because I want you to think about yourself right now. You're sitting in a room and you're spending a whole day out of the office, maybe tomorrow too. What is the value of this? It doesn't matter how much you paid. The biggest important thing is you paid in time because you could be back at the office doing something else. What's your value? Your value is you met somebody who you haven't met before that could be important for you in the future. Networking, good networking. That is good value. Second value, you have learned something that you can take from here and implement into your work on Monday morning when you get back into your office. That's a second value. Third, you learned something about a new product that you didn't even know existed. These are values we want. We want tangible outcomes from these meetings. And that's what our clients want as well. So every time you're a conference attendee, think about your clients as well and think about how you can make their life more valuable and better as well. And this brings me really to the end of it. Conclusion in general is we are living in a world that's changing very, very quickly. We go through an industrial revolution right now with artificial intelligence and robotics. We go through a very difficult, tumultuous political times. We go through an environmental crisis right now that we don't know where we're going to come out at the end of it. But one of the things we have still on our side is people are meeting to find solutions to all these problems. The solutions to all these problems we have in our own hands. Conferences are solutions, and we just need to realize again that this is our purpose of doing this. So let's not focus on the negative, let's focus on the positive. Meetings are on the uprise, and we have a lot of work to do, and there's a lot of issues to solve in the next few years. Thank you.
네, 큰 박수 부탁드리겠습니다. Thank you very much for your presentation. 네, 변하지 않은 이 가치가 사람과 사람 사이의 어떤 교류라고 말씀해 주신 게 굉장히 기억에 남습니다. 자, 이렇게 두 번째 주제 강연 수고를 해주셨는데요. 이어서 패널 토론 수고해 주실 분들 모셔보도록 하겠습니다. 좌장은 황희곤 한림대학교 교수님께서 수고를 해주실 예정이시고요. 또 발표를 수고해 주신 마티아스 포슈 대표님, 윤영혜 동덕여자대학교 교수님, 그리고 이경재 서울관광재단 팀장님, 오성환 이오컴백스 대표님께서 패널로 함께해 주시겠습니다. 단상으로 모시겠습니다. 네, 착석을 부탁드리고요. 저희 패널 토론은 역시 약 20분 정도 진행이 됩니다. 6시 5분경에 마무리될 수 있도록 좌장님 참고를 부탁드리겠습니다. 앉으신 자리에서 네, 앉으신 자리에서 네, 마이크는 버튼을 누르시고 말씀하시면 되겠습니다. 자, 그럼 패널 토론 시작하겠습니다. 박수로 환영해 주시면 감사하겠습니다.
항상 제가 느끼는 건데 컨벤션을 전공하는 사람이 항상 시간을 좀 못 지켜서 좀 죄송하게 생각하거든요. 그래서 저희는 짧고 아주 컴팩트하게 진행해 보겠습니다. 우선 그 오늘 패널 세 분 소개 좀 드리겠습니다. 우리 오성환 회장님, 전 마이세피 회장이시고 인사 한번 하시죠. 예, 우리 박수 한번 보내드릴까요? 예, 회장님. 예. 네. 그다음에
네, 반갑습니다.
네, 교수님 마이크를 다시 한번.
예, 제가 앞에 두 분 그 얘기를 좀 들으면서 어떤 빅데이터 또 우리의 미래상 이런 것 좀 얘기했는데 지금 우리 포시 요번에 발표는 상당히 우리와 바로 가까이 있는 얘기였던 것 같습니다. 아마 제가 최근에 컨벤션 또는 마이스 들은 얘기를 가장 그 피부에 와닿는 얘기를 많이 해서 너무 좀 고맙게 생각합니다. I very appreciate your speech. 그래서 저는 그냥 이렇게 세 분한테 이런 질문을 해볼게요. 좋은 발표를 하셨는데 지금같이 이렇게 빅데이터든지 이렇게 크게 변하는 시대에 우리 컨벤션 업계가 이게 뭐 PCO든 아니면 뭐 스플라이어든 아니면 베뉴든 이 컨벤션 업계가 좀 뭘 어떻게 좀 변화해야 되는지 뭐 그런 것들에 대해서 말씀 좀 해주시고 그 다음에 세 분이 생각할 때 가장 중요한 프로포즈를 한두 가지 정도만 뭐 이런 건 좀 했으면 좋겠다. 그게 뭐 정책이든 막 우리 고객들에 대한 얘기든 간에 그래서 한 두 가지 포인트로 큰 변화에 우리 컨벤션 업계가 어떻게 대처해 갈 것인가. 그 다음에 또 그러기 위해서 뭐 우리 민간 업계든 아니면 우리 정부 정책 차원에서 뭐 어떤 점이 좀 가장 중요하다. 뭐 이런 정도로 한번 얘기를 해줬으면 좋겠습니다. 우리 회장님 먼저 하실까요?
네.
예, 그렇게 하시죠. 예.
그렇게 할게. 그런데 오늘 그 주제 발표한 거에 대한 내용을 토론하는 걸로 알고 있었는데 어쨌든 저는 이어컨 백세 오성환입니다. 그 제 자리가 저긴 줄 알았더니 나이 순으로 앉으라 그래서 제가 젊어서 발표자 바로 옆에 앉았습니다. 미스터 매티스 포시가 그 IAPCO라고 International Association of Professional Congress Organizer, PCO 협회 국제협회 회장이신데 제가 오늘 여기 나온 거는 KAPCO라고 있어요. 한국. 거기에 목수로 나왔는데 우리 회장님 또 어디 가시고 몇 번 하다가 그 한국 PCO 중에서 제가 제일 한가해서 오늘 나오게 됐습니다. 그래서 그 제가 먼저 미스터 매티스 포시한테 간단한 질문 하나 드릴게요. 영어로. Can you guess how many PCOs are there in Korea? Right one.
Ah,
yeah, softly.
The one that says on and off. Thank you. Yeah, that's usually why I'm behind the scenes and not on the stage. I think I heard this number. It's about 300.
300.
Yeah. Sorry.
Thank. 한국의 그 PCO 숫자는 그 한국의 PCO 숫자는 로컬 가버먼트, 지방정부에 등록을 해야 되는 그런 업종이기 때문에 굉장히 정확합니다. More than 1,000, 1,000개가 넘고 있습니다. 제가 오늘 좀 드리는 말씀이 PCO들이 그럼 어떻게 다 먹고 살 거냐 하는 문제가 사실 PCO들의 제일 관건인데 제가 그럼 PCO 어떻게 먹고 살아요? 그 싱가포르에서 오신 것 같은데 싱가포르에는 PCO들이 어떻게 먹고 삽니까? 하는 걸 물어보고 싶은데 그거는 내일 세션이 있어서 그거는 내일 그 로 좀 미루기로 하고요. 오늘 제가 좀 여쭤보고 싶은 거는 여기 이제 그 우리나라에는 이제 국제 규격의 컨벤션 센터가 2000년대 코엑스부터 시작해 가지고 올해까지 해서 11개 수원 컨벤션 센터, 지금 천안과 울산과 몇 군데가 더 준비하고 있어요. 컨벤션 센터가 지어지기 전까지는 한국에 컨벤션은 없었습니다. 아까 이카 데이터로 해서 한국이 뭐 그 서울이 2위고 아시아에서 3위고 한국이 9위고 또 얼마 전에 UIA라는 곳에서 지난 60년 동안의 통계를 보면 한국이 뭐 5위다 뭐다 이런 숫자가 불과 20년도 되지 않은 한국의 컨벤션 시장을 통해서 나온 거라는 얘기는 대한민국에서 컨벤션에서 먹고 사는 사람들이 정말 열심히 했다라고 생각하진 않아요. 그거는 오로지 이유가 이거는 공급이 수요를 창출하는 시장이기 때문에 컨벤션 센터 수천억의 킨텍스 조 단위가 넘는 그런 중앙정부나 지방정부가 컨벤션 센터를 지어줬기 때문에 그리고 불과 10년 전에 2009년도에 대한민국에서 신성장 동력이라 그래서 대한민국이 앞으로 20년 동안 먹고 살아가야 될 17가지 새로운 성장 동력 산업 거기에 마이스 관광을 지정을 했기 때문에 많은 사람들이 이 컨벤션에서 먹고 살겠다고 들어왔기 때문에 그래요. 제 말 이해가 You understand what I'm talking about? Interpretation 잘 되고 있죠. 그래서 제가 좀 여쭤보고 싶은 거는 대한민국은 그러니까 외국과 달리 민간 주도가 아닌 관 주도로 되어 있어요. 그런데 2009년에 정말 지원해 줄 것처럼 하더니 안 하는 거예요. 지금 여기도 고향 돈으로 하고 있거든요, 이 행사. 맞죠? 그럼 고향 시장님 잠깐 있다가 가셨어요. 관심이 없다는 거예요. 이거 이 문제에 대해서 그래서 그 저는 그 미스터 한국 사람 입장에서가 아닌 국제 PCO 협회면은 그 한국에 있는 PCO들도 좀 챙기셔야 되니까 한국에서 한국 정부가 혹은 지방 정부가 PCO 컨벤션 산업을 위해서 어떤 역할을 해야 되는지에 대한 그런 어떤 코멘트를 좀 듣고 싶습니다. 드릴 말씀은 엄청 많은데 늦어져 가지고 제가 여기까지만 질문 드릴게요.
예. 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 아, 지금 우리 전체 아, 오케이. The wrap up is the last time is the you are no no. Not now.
Not answer?
Yeah. Okay.
예, 반갑습니다. 네. 예, 반갑습니다. 서울 관광재단에서 온 이경재라고 합니다. 마티 스포시 분께서 전체적으로 그 이카 데이터를 좀 말씀 주셨는데 서울은 참고로 그 2018년 기준으로 해서 UI 기준으로는 이제 세 번째 글로벌 마이스 도시고요. 그다음에 이카 기준으로는 이제 15위를 하고 있습니다. 서울에서는 지금 그 랭킹을 더 높이기 위한 이제 많은 그 작업들을 하고 있고요. 지금 이제 일례로 그 국제 회의가 대부분 이제 그 100명에서 이제 300명 수준의 중소형 컨벤션들이 이루어지고 있습니다. 반대로 그 3,000명 이상의 대형 그런 이제 컨벤션들도 굉장히 많이 일어나고 있고요. 오늘 이제 전체적으로 그 4차 산업에 관련된 이야기들이 굉장히 많았는데 이런 4차 산업, IT나 BT, 그다음에 뭐 머신러닝, 딥러닝 같은 이제 그런 4차 산업에 관련된 그런 국제 회의들도 굉장히 많이 생겨나고 있습니다. 제가 상반기에 그 머신러닝 관련된 이제 국제 회의들을 계속 진행을 했었는데 이게 그 규모가 12,000명입니다. 그 저희가 통상적으로 이제 큰 행사들 하면은 이제 1,000명 단위들을 이제 논의를 하는데 이제 최근에 이런 어떤 4차 산업과 관련된 그런 이제 미팅들은 이제 만 단위로 넘어가지 않나. 그래서 그런 거에 대한 서울도 많은 준비를 해야겠다. 특히 서울은 이제 그동안에 그 코엑스밖에 없었기 때문에 이런 컨벤션 센터를 새로 만들기 위한 작업들을 준비를 하고 있고요. 저희가 2025년까지 이제 잠실 복합지구에 10만 스퀘어미터의 이제 그 센터를 보유하게 됩니다. 그래서 그런 센터들을 보유하게 되면은 이제 이런 대형 행사들을 더 많이 유치하고 또 개최할 수 있지 않을까라는 생각을 하게 됩니다. 지금 그 오성환 대표님께서 이제 PCO 입장을 대변해서 이렇게 말씀을 주셨는데요. 그 저희가 9월 달에 그 세계 변호사 협회 총회를 코엑스에서 이제 진행을 하게 됩니다. 그 작년 하반기부터 제가 그 세계 변호사 협회 의장을 모시고 이제 시장도 뵙고 여러 가지 그 활동들을 했었는데요. 굉장히 아쉬웠던 부분이 이게 사실은 그 세계 변호사 협회 총회를 서울에서 유치함에도 불구하고 실질적으로 이 행사를 주최하는 거는 인하우스 PCO 그러니까 영국 회사가 모든 걸 다 가져갑니다. 그리고 한국에 있는 이제 업체, 그러니까 PCO들은 그 중에 이제 조금 작은 부분, 힘들고 어려운 이제 이런 부분들 위주로 이렇게 가기 때문에 결국은 행사를 서울에 유치함에도 불구하고 이런 어떤 프로핏 부분들은 그 이제 글로벌 업체들이 좀 가져가지 않나라는 좀 그런 아쉬운 점들을 생각을 하면서 적어도 그 향후에는 그 민관, 그러니까 저희 같은 이제 기관들하고 이제 그 PCO들하고 좀 협력을 해서 글로벌 어떤 그 국제 회의들을 실질적으로 만들고 이런 것들을 뭐 아태 또 더 크게는 이제 글로벌한 이런 미팅들을 만들고 유치하고 이런 그 좀 작업들도 같이 하면 좋겠다라는 그 생각들을 좀 해봅니다. 제가 하나 좀 제안을 드리는 거는요. 그 저희가 그 국내적으로 그 서울과 그 타시도 간의 어떤 이제 상생하는 그런 사업들을 지금 추진을 하고 있습니다. 그 최근에 이제 강원도나 이제 광주광역시하고 그 작업들을 진행을 하고 있는데요. 여기 있는 이제 뭐 고양시하고도 같이 코업을 해서 이런 좀 그 국내에 그 타시도 간에 같이 상생하고 협력해서 좀 글로벌화 할 수 있는 이제 그런 바탕들을 좀 마련했으면 좋을 것 같고요. 또 대외적으로는 저희가 요즘 이제 글로벌 마이스 얼라이언스를 좀 준비를 하고 있습니다. 그래서 좀 서울이 마이스 리딩 도시로 중심을 잡고 아시아나 이런 유럽 도시들을 같이 코웍해서 이런 얼라이언스들을 만들고 이 얼라이언스들을 기초로 해서 이런 어떤 그 이카가 얘기하는 3대륙을 이제 순회하는 이런 글로벌 좀 회의들을 서울로 더 많이 유치할 수 있는 이런 그 기초를 좀 마련하고자 합니다. 그래서 이런 어떤 대내적으로나 대외적으로 이런 좀 노력들이 좀 결실을 맺게 되면 서울로 또 한국으로 이런 국제회의들을 더 많이 유치할 수 있다라고 생각하고 있습니다. 네.
아 너무 서울 좋은 얘기 많이 하셔서 경기도 고향이 되게 약간 힘들어지는 느낌이 좀 드네. 예, 다음은 우리 윤영혜 교수님.
네, 동덕여자대학교 글로벌 마이스 전공 윤영혜입니다. 앞서 말씀하셨던 PCO 측의 입장 그리고 STO에서 베뉴를 바라보는 입장 충분히 이해되고 저긴 여기에 좀 덧붙여서 말씀을 드리고 싶은 게 사실 이경재 팀장님께서는 해외에서 이 레베뉴를 다 가져가는 게 아쉽다고 하시지만 고향시 입장에서는 사실 서울한테 좀 아쉬운 부분이 많지 않을까라는 생각이 듭니다. 베뉴는 여긴데 돈은 다 이제 서울 가서 쓰고 오는 이런 부분들이 분명히 존재하고 있습니다. 이 그 회장님의 발표를 들으면서 제가 굉장히 걱정됐던 거는 이 베뉴에서 센터의 비중이 선호도가 굉장히 급격하게 낮아지고 있다는 부분입니다. 이게 저희는 사실 좋은 것만 보고 싶지만 그렇게 안 좋은 부분들에 대해서도 미리 대처를 하는 부분이 필요한데 지금 대한민국 같은 경우는 오 대표님 말씀하셨지만 신축하고 확장하는 컨벤션 센터들이 많아지고 있습니다. 지금 현재로 한 30만 스퀘어미터 정도 있는데 계속 2025년까지 확장을 해나가면 50만에 육박하는 거의 40만이 조금 넘는 이 그 메뉴들을 전부 센터로 가지게 되는 상황입니다. 그래서 저희는 지금 많은 전략이 필요하고 그런 상황에서 고양시와 서울시가 협업해서 혹은 다른 시도와 협업해서 전략을 가져가는 게 굉장히 중요하다는 생각이 듭니다. 그 한 포인트가 있었고요. 또 한 가지의 포인트는 이제 발표하신 대표님도 PCO를 운영하고 계시고 PCO 협회 회장이시기 때문에 정말 궁금한 건 앞으로 PCO들이 가져야 될 역량입니다. 저희 학교에서도 사실은 앞으로 PCO가 되기 위해서 어떤 교육을 해야 미래에 성공적으로 이 업계를 이끌어 갈 수 있냐를 많이 고민해서 지난 학기에는 이런 수업도 한번 열어봤습니다. International Association 과 마이스를 같이 공부할 수 있는 그래서 어소시에이션을 아까 말씀하신 대로 회원을 유지 관리하고 그 전략을 같이 발굴해 줄 수 있는 PCO가 단순히 뭐 의전을 하고 하스피탈리티를 하고 그리고 어떤 그 로지스틱만 하는 게 아니라 어떤 전략과 기획을 함께 할 수 있는 그런 인재를 기르려고 학교에서 많이 노력을 하고 있습니다. 이러한 부분들에 대해서 질문을 드리고 싶습니다. 현재 지금 글로벌 PCO에서는 어떻게 미래 방향의 PCO의 core competence를 정하시고 그걸 교육하기 위해서 어떤 노력을 하고 계신지 그 부분에 대해서 질문 드리고 싶습니다.
우리 세 분 패널 분들 정말 좋은 말씀 주셨는데 아마 지금 우리 지금 컨벤션 업계의 어려움이랄지 또는 미래에 대한 바램이다 포함되어 있는 것을 제가 간단히 정리해 보면 첫 번째는 우리 지금 컨벤션 산업에서 정부의 역할을 어떻게 정의할 거냐. Okay, the first. The government role of the convention and mice industry. Yeah? 두 번째는 지금 서울시 얘기로 지금 국제회의를 만들어서 우리가 좀 부가가치를 높이고 싶다. 저 그냥 수주하고 이러는 것이 아니고 그런 것에 대해서 그러니까 the second question is to create a new convention and so and promote the more added value. 그 다음에는 지금 도시 간의 협력을 통해서 우리가 뭔가 좀 새로운 좀 가치를 만들자는 그게 뭐 꼭 서울이 중심이 더 좋고 다른 좋고 그래서 between the cities and between the regions and the cooperate the more cooperate convention and so. 이제 마지막이 되게 중요한데 우리 윤 교수님 얘기는 앞으로 PCO의 미래가 어떻게 될 거냐 그에 맞춰서 우리가 인력을 양성을 하고 그 다음에 대비를 해야 되는데 과연 그러면 in the future the what is the role of the PCO and the convention industry? Yeah, it's just the four questions. Okay.
First of, I have, so first of all, there's a workshop tomorrow afternoon that is 3 hours that all of these questions are going to be discussed, number one. Number two is, so I have something that might not everybody might like to hear, but I don't think association meetings belong in the my sector. The my sector itself is flawed because it only combines the interest of the supplier, a hotel or a convention center. It does not combine the interest of the client. They are very different. If I want to do an incentive trip, that's very different than doing an association meeting. So inherently, we're facing this problem that we cannot argue for our industry with politicians because it's so complex by now, the interests are so different that it is very difficult for us to argue it. For example, when we talked about the exhibition centers not being used that much anymore, I speak for associations. For conferences and for exhibitions, for example, it's still used, right? So because it declines here, it might kind of incline somewhere else. And it's these trends are very hard to see because I'm only speaking for one sector. The other thing that really comes when you take conferences out, you realize that conferences are not a tourism item. The number one reason, tourism is just what gets us there. Tourism is what gets us there and where people sleep. That's the framework. But what conferences are about is science, medicine, technology. And a country and a city and a government would be very well served looking at this and saying, I get International Bar Association, 6,000 fantastic lawyers that are discussing human rights issues into our city. There is so much brain power in our city, so much we can leverage this. This can move our city forward. I get 7,000 researchers into my city that deal with a cancer or whatever. This can bring Seoul, Goyang, Korea forward if we invest in this, if we get the most out of these people. And don't just calculate how many room nights did they stay and did they book a convention center. That is a very small item of what these people have to offer. And very small when you look on the long term, what they can offer to a destination to move it forward. So my opinion is the way we get better value with governments for association conferences is to give a better value argument. It's not room nights. It's not kind of like, did you use a PCO or not? Even though that's very important, I'm a PCO, I want you to use me, I know. But at the end of the day, what's the long-term impact on the destination for hosting this? And Sydney, who was, for example, mentioned as a great example for environmental research, they've done research in this as well, with one of the conferences we've done in Sydney, and they've realized, because a conference has happened, our local doctors are more involved in international research. They have fostered relationships that are gonna move forward the healthcare in the country. All of those things, if you look at this, we have a much better argument, much stronger. And last but not least, the one thing I wanna also say about the other question about the PCOs only getting a small piece. I agree, but so my history with Seoul or Korea is long. My first big meeting in Asia I did in Korea in 2007, the World Conference on Lung Cancer at COEX. That was the first time I worked in Asia, and it was a fantastic experience. But one thing I haven't seen change since then is the mindset is very Korean. It used to be back then, it still is. And what I mean with that is, if an international client comes in, it's not always very adapted to the international needs. We work with the International Bar Association, and I can tell you, the interesting thing was when we looked for a local partner, we wrote to 7 or 8 PCOs, we got 3 answers. And it's a very big piece of business. But I know now why. Mr. Oh is one of the ones who's easy to work with because he has a very, very internet. But the reason was that I talked to some of my friends who are PCOs in Korea, and I said, why didn't you answer it? They said they didn't believe my RFP because this is not how things are done in Korea. Nobody just sends out an RFP like this and says, like, you get this piece of business if you meet with me. There's no local involved. We don't need to meet with the local. We're not having any of these. So there is still a need for this international understanding and an openness to international business. And I think Korea has everything it needs to play much stronger on an Asia-Pacific and international market. You have 300 PCOs, or 1,000 PCOs, sorry, 300 is my fake number, fake news. But you have a lot of very qualified PCOs here, very. Everybody I worked with is extremely qualified, and they can do a lot, but I think it's this next step, which is still needed. Sorry.
Okay, I wonder that is the problem is only English ability or cultural difference? I really want to know that.
And I think that's the problem for Asia-Pacific meetings to begin with.
I think Asia-Pacific meetings are a future, but language and culture in Asia is very different than it is across Europe or across North America. It's not as homogenous. So as much as this is a great goal for us to have here in Asia, I think it's still very difficult for us to get over that. And that really comes with what you said in the last part, and your question is, what's the most important talent that PCOs need to have to survive in the future? And I think this cross-cultural understanding, which includes language, but also includes this openness. And I don't mean understanding only kind of like Westerners. This starts with understanding other Asian countries and other Asian cultures as well. Like this is, there's so much diversity here. And this will help the Korean MICE market really moving forward and all the PCOs to get business outside of Korea as well, because I think that's the goal. It's a global industry. And the reason why so many people use the same PCO is it is so complex. If I get to know a conference really well, sometimes it takes me 2 years just to get to know the conference. And so the client wants to still work with the same PCO. So the same is available to Korean PCOs.
Okay, and my short question and your long answer, frankly speaking, is not enough for me. But we have no time today, so let's talk over later, okay?
3 hours tomorrow afternoon. It's a long session.
그, 그 방금 들으면서 제가 생각한 게 그 해외 그 대사관들의 얘기를 들어보면 유럽은 프랑스, 영국 이렇게 같이 모임이 있고 북미 모임이 있는데 똑같이 생각 같은 발로 보는데 한중일 모임은 잘 없대요. 그게 다른 분들 생각할 때 아시아 컬처가 비슷하다고 생각하는데 절대 그렇지가 않다. 아시아는 더 다르다라는 얘기를 제가 전공이 좀 그래서 들었는데 제가 오늘 좀 느끼면서 들은 것은 첫째는 지금 우리 정부의 역할이 상당히 또는 지자체 역할이 크죠. 근데 저는 우리 의사결정자 공부를 좀 해야 되겠다. 이 산업에 대한 좀 더 많은 스터디를 좀 해줘야 되겠다. 뭐 이런 생각을 좀 개인적으로 해봤고요. 그 다음에 우리 그 컨벤션 업계도 제가 오늘 IPCO 얘기를 들으면서 과연 그러면 우리 국내의 데이터랄지 그것이 아니지 않느냐 우리도 모르면서 이걸 뭘 한다는 게 조금 좀 그렇다 그래서 우리 스스로도 오늘 계속 데이터 얘기가 많이 나왔는데 정확한 데이터 뭐 그런 걸 바탕으로 해서 우리 미래를 좀 내다보고 우리의 문제를 좀 정확하게 직시하고 좀 대안을 만들어보자 그런 생각을 좀 해봤습니다 어쨌든 지금은 빨리 맞추는 게 중요할 것 같아요 그래서 뭐 정말 그 정말 좀 내가 고맙게 생각하는 것은 우리 IAPCO 회장님 와서 정말 좋은 걸 하신 것 같아요. 또 그리고 토론 세분 너무 고맙습니다. 뜨겁게 박수 모아서 끝내도록 하겠습니다. 예.
네, 여러분 다시 한번 박수 부탁드리겠습니다. 네, 고맙습니다.